1433, 1492, 1789, 1914, 1945. How did such dates creep into our collective memory? Who decided which ones were memorable? How is an event constructed? Why? And for whom? And how does it end up in history textbooks? The historian Patrick Boucheron looks back at some of these famous dates to see how they help us grasp the broader sweep of world history. After all, there are many different calendars in the world, not one version of history, but a multitude of intertwined histories. So let's pan out, take a different perspective, and study with Patrick Boucheron the mechanism by which history is made. 1492 was officially the year the Americas were discovered, marking the end of the Middle Ages and the beginning of modern times. Yet it's possible that Christopher Columbus setting foot on a West Indian beach one day in October obscures a far more complex story, one that begins in Granada, in Andalusia, and casts Western modernity in a slightly different light.
We can't just casually walk into history through an open door. We can only approach it through the filter of the memory of an event. Consequently, we can't just say, now we're going to talk about 1492, as if it was the first time we'd ever heard this date mentioned. Christopher Columbus is a childhood memory. And faced with this childhood memory, history carries very little weight. It's not just because an historian tells you this is how it happened that you're going to believe them. Because it's rich with childhood, because it's rich with emotion, with passion, all this needs to be taken into account when you talk about 1492.
We'll call this part of India San Salvador. And I take possession of it in the name of the King and Queen of Spain.
In the collective memory, that's what the discovery of America is. An event painted in childhood colors. But the year 1492 itself has a thickness, a density, a complexity which we're here to explore. The story to be told begins with a foot. A foot placed on a beach. Not just any old foot, but that of a Genoese navigator called Christopher Columbus. This foot is standing on unknown land, even if the adventurer doesn't know it yet. Unknown to whom? To Europeans, of course. Which doesn't give us the authority to talk about the discovery of America, but simply about the meeting of two worlds mutually unaware of each other. So was the 12th of October 1492 the event of the year? Christopher Columbus placing his foot on a beach? I don't think so. The resounding event of that year more likely took place on the 2nd of January. With the capitulation of Granada, when Isabella of Castile and Ferdinand of Aragon, those who we call the Catholic monarchs, laid hands on the last Muslim enclave of the Iberian Peninsula. This was obviously an extraordinary piece of world news, which made a resounding impact, as did their decision on the 31st of March to expel the Jews. So, the 12th of October was basically the third world event of the year 1492. And Christopher Columbus's voyage needs to be considered in the light of these two previous dates. This was the year in which Jorge de Aguiar drew this map representing the known world of the 15th century. Rather skimpy knowledge in reality, which is precise only around the coastal fringes, similar to a Portland chart used by ships' captains. Only a few Iberian cities are shown: Lisbon, Seville, and Granada, where the year's events were being played out. But the city is flanked by another, smaller one, founded by the Catholic monarchs as a siege position. This new city was built to defy Granada in the style of a Roman military camp. Its name, Santa Fe. Opposite the intricate alleyways of the Arab city, a geometrical city which besieges and commands it. Stiff and straight, with angular streets, this is a different vision of world order. A different vision, too, of how men should be governed. This is the vision soon to be applied to the new world. The conquistador was to impose this model of the orthonormal city everywhere. And this geometric form would be accompanied by the name Santa Fe, sacred faith, a proclamation of glory. In New Mexico, in Argentina, in Colombia, whose present-day capital, Bogotá, was originally named Santa Fe de Bogotá, Santa Fe was everywhere. But let us first talk about the ancient world, the one before America. It had been described since antiquity as a complete world, made up of three interconnected parts and surrounded by sea. Medieval world maps represented it as merchants and travelers saw it, but also as they imagined it. This was the case with Marco Polo, with all his literature about the marvels of the world which Christopher Columbus had passionately devoured.
Then one day, a mapmaker named Christopher Columbus had an idea.
Do you know what? I think the world isn't flat at all. I think it's round like a ball.
Did you hear what he said? Did you hear what he said? He said that the world is round. Oh,
he's crazy, man. I think the world isn't flat at all. I think it's round like a ball.
This image, however, is the fruit of our contemporary imagination. Because, contrary to popular legend, it was not Christopher Columbus who proved the sphericity of the Earth to medieval savants who were convinced that it was flat. "I have always read that the world of land and water was spherical," wrote Christopher Columbus in his log. But he then added, "Now I have discovered that it is not round, but pear-shaped. Or rather, like a round ball, on which is placed something like a female nipple. And this nipple is the highest mountain and the closest to heaven." A strange explorer, whose observations stray from reality to accommodate his own dream. On a wiser note, the geographer Martin Behaim gave the name Apple to the globe which he completed in Nuremberg on the 17th of June of this same year of 1492. It's the oldest known globe in existence. It's interesting to note how narrow the Atlantic appears between Europe and Asia. From Cape Verde and the Azores on one side to the Sipangu Mass on the other. Sipangu is portrayed just as Marco Polo drew the Japanese archipelago. Martin Behaim has depicted a group of little scattered islands straight out of medieval legend. They almost look like stepping stones, inviting you to cross. What they teach you in school is quite straightforward. In 1492, America was discovered, and this event marked the beginning of modernity. In other words, we basically switched from medieval times to modern times with the help of one heroic and glorious act, in a way which is completely in line with Western rationality. But what was the cost of this modernity? That's the question which arises when you take into account the depth of the year 1492, by which I mean the 2nd of January, the 31st of March, and the 12th of October altogether. During the night of the 1st to the 2nd of January, the Alhambra Citadel finally fell, and with it Granada, the last stronghold of Muslim Spain. The victors were Ferdinand of Aragon and Isabella of Castile. Their marriage, 20 years earlier, sealed the union of the two Iberian crowns. It was a prince who surrendered, the Emir Abu Abdallah Muhammad XII, known as the Unfortunate, who would be remembered in the West by the name of Boabdil. The Islamic world regretted for a long time having lost these Andalusian splendors. There's a mountain pass overlooking Granada, which today bears the name the Moor's Sigh. It was here that Boabdil is said to have turned to take one last look at what he had lost. What had he lost? Firstly, a powerful and prosperous state. A state founded upon the advanced hydraulic system used to cultivate the crops. A state reflected in the delicate beauty of the Alhambra's ponds and fountains. During a visit in 1494, a German traveler remarked that everything is so magnificent, so majestic, so deliciously crafted that anyone gazing upon it could think themselves in paradise. Paradise also signified garden in the Arabo-Persian culture. Struck by the beauty of the city which they'd just conquered, the Catholic monarchs wished to conserve it as a trophy. Paradoxically, this conquest was thus responsible for conserving, almost fossilizing, the only Islamic palatial city which can today be admired in its entirety. It provides the European imagination with a glimpse of the Oriental dream, frozen in time. But before that, the Catholic monarchs enthusiastically pursue their quest for the sacred faith. Granada is where they accept Boabdil's surrender. Granada is also where they order that the Jews be expelled from their kingdom of Aragon and of Castile. They give them until the 2nd of August to choose between conversion and exile. What we need to understand is that, of course, there had been expulsions before 1492. There had been pogroms. There was a despairingly long history of anti-Judaism in Europe. This was not the first occurrence. But at the same time, the order to expel the Jews from Spain came as a truly cutting blow in the 2,000-year history of Judaism in Spain. This time, they must actually leave. They leave a few weeks or months after the 31st of March decree. They take flight. But where to? Towards Italy, Ferrara, Rome. But this was often just a stop-off point on the way to the Ottoman Empire. And so began the great exile known as the Sephardic diaspora. In the Royal Chapel of Granada, the mausoleums of the Catholic monarchs contemplate the altarpiece, which depicts the taking of Granada and the conversion of Jews. Because this war was also a war of images. It was a question of immediately showing the world, in the style of a live broadcast, that a new Catholic Spain was being born. Without appreciating the feverishness of this religious exaltation, we can't understand why the Catholic monarchs finally let themselves be persuaded by the project of the Genoese navigator Christopher Columbus. For a very long time, we nurtured this image of Christopher Columbus as an intrepid and calculating navigator, a hero of reason. Today, we're almost inclined to take the opposite view, to see in him a hero of unreason, of medieval madness. His mysticism is almost feverish. He's expecting the end of time, perhaps even wants to precipitate it. He wants to carry on the crusade by other means. So, in Christopher Columbus, there is, of course, a search for riches. He wants power. Why not discover some lands? But at the same time, he has this ardent wish to push ever further and by new means the Christian struggle for evangelization and conquest. In April, Christopher Columbus begins negotiating the conditions of his voyage. This is what we call the Capitulations of Santa Fe. Today, if I talk about capitulation, it means unconditional surrender. To capitulate means to abandon. In fact, it means the opposite, because capitulations are chapters. Chapters of what? Of a negotiation, where the details of a voyage are laid down. It needs to be financed, it needs to be organized, it needs advanced planning. If there are profits, how are they divided up? All of that needs to be discussed face to face. In the terms of the Capitulations of Santa Fe, it was stated that upon his return, Christopher Columbus would tell the Catholic monarchs, and only the Catholic monarchs, what happened during the voyage. So we know that in Barcelona he gave a document to the Catholic monarchs. This document has been lost. We also know that the Catholic monarchs gave a copy of this document back to Christopher Columbus. This copy has also been lost. But through slightly curious circumstances, we have a copy of this copy, which is known as the log of Christopher Columbus. But, of course, we have to ask ourselves what we are looking at. For example, sometimes in the supposed log of Christopher Columbus, it's written in the first person and sometimes in the third person. The admiral says that is clearly someone else's copy. So, in fact, the log of Christopher Columbus isn't, strictly speaking, a ship's log. And the Capitulations of Santa Fe isn't exactly the document we expect it to be either. So, everything in the documentary evidence about 1492 is a bit complicated. But that's nothing to get depressed about. Historians regularly face the same problem when studying an event based on its reconstruction by the collective memory. In 1992, for the Universal Exposition of Seville and for the 500th anniversary of Columbus's voyage, copies were built of the three caravels which took part in the expedition. Similarly, the story which has been told is also a reconstruction. Santa Maria, Pinta, Niña. Three caravels leave the Andalusian port of Palos on the 3rd of August. They make a stop off at the Canary Islands before beginning their long Atlantic crossing. Following an extraordinary series of calculation errors and a biased interpretation of certain books, the Genoese navigator had managed to convince himself that the world was smaller than people thought. If he had calculated the distance correctly, he would never have gone. In a certain way, that's what saved him. Firstly, it spared him a lot of anguish. When you read Christopher Columbus's log, nothing suggests that he is worried, either by a jump into the unknown or by the vastness. 10 days after leaving the Canaries and heading due west, the sight of birds in flight and seaweed which looks like river grasses convince him that islands are nearby. On the 17th of September, he sees a crab. 2 days later, an albatross. Land is close. He is sure of it. The sailors are on the brink of mutiny and want to change direction.
Turn back, Columbus! Turn back, Columbus!
We'll not turn back until we find India. Onward, men!
On the 12th of October, they finally land. It's a tiny island which Christopher Columbus immediately names San Salvador. The moment seems sacred to him, loaded with mysticism. He had thought he was reliving the Exodus and finds himself in Revelations, setting foot in paradise. In Columbus's log, we read, "They go about as naked as the day they were born, even the women. And all the men I saw were young, none older than 30. They were all well built, with very fine bodies and welcoming faces. They carry no weapons and seem unaware of their use. When I showed them a sword, they took it by the blade and injured themselves." In fact, this logbook of Christopher Columbus's is known to us because Bartolomé de las Casas, much later on, in his Historia de las Indias, transcribed large extracts of it. But he himself had his own axe to grind. Bartolomé de las Casas, who was Bishop of Chiapas, energetically campaigned against the massacres by the conquistadors in America. So his purpose is basically to portray Christopher Columbus as the golden age of conquest and its lost innocence. A bygone time, when the innocence of an exchange, the honesty of nakedness, and the possibility of an encounter still seemed possible. This 16th century image wants to portray all these things, even though the massacres by the conquistadors had long since shattered this dream of a golden age. On the 21st of October, he continues his voyage and sets sail for a large island. It was Cuba, or in any case, we know today that it was Cuba. But Christopher Columbus was only prepared to believe what he had read in Marco Polo's Book of Marvels. The Indians talked of Chibao, from where the name Cuba comes, and Columbus heard Chipangu, the name which Marco Polo had given to Japan, where the houses were said to have golden roofs. This conjured up in his readers the promise of gold, of conversion, of a crusade. A crusade which he is convinced will soon follow to purify Spain and promote Christianity. Would Columbus at some point realize that he wasn't where he thought he was? Not necessarily, because each time that the indigenous people tell him something, he hears it as proof that he was right all along. For example, when someone says, "Don't go any further because there are canibas." Be careful. They eat humans. In fact, the word cannibal comes from this ethnonym, canibas. But instead, Columbus hears people of the great Khan, the Chinese emperor, who he wants to meet. And Marco Polo never said anything about them being cannibals, so the locals are mistaken. Columbus and his companions leave again on the 2nd of January 1493. And arrive back in Lisbon on the 4th of March, convinced of having touched the edge of the world. Meanwhile, if we take a look at other news from around the world, Duchess Anne is crowned Queen of France at Saint-Denis Abbey on the 8th of February. 2 months earlier, her marriage to King Charles VIII brings the Duchy of Brittany back into the kingdom. Florence mourns the death of Lorenzo the Magnificent, benefactor of Leonardo da Vinci, who probably drew his famous Vitruvian Man in this same year, making the human body the yardstick of all things. But there were other shining princes in the world, unpainted princes. Have you heard of Suni Ali Ber, ruler of the Songhai Empire, which from its capital of Gao, he expanded as far as Djen and Timbuktu? The great and beautiful and learned Timbuktu. He was one of the powerful sovereigns of his time, just like Thammachetti, the builder king of the Buddhist kingdom of Pegu, in the south of today's Myanmar, who also died during this year of 1492. At the end of the year, Martin Alonso Pinzon, who had been Columbus's unruly captain, died of an unknown illness. It was probably syphilis. This American illness which was to ravage Europe. At the same time, the conquistadors brought flu and other viruses with them, which spread death amongst the Indians. The microbic unification of the world had begun. The year 1492, or in any case the one which is taught in schools, is the dividing line between the Middle Ages and modern times. Meaning that after Christopher Columbus, we enter a new phase of history. It's not just that we gain access to the new world, it's that this new world represents a new time. However, it's not that simple, because we've seen that Christopher Columbus was full of medieval mysticism from having read books of the Middle Ages. And because if we think about history after him, with American colonization, it continues to be a period of feverish medievalism, feuds, and conquests. What set foot in America was not at all a modern, humanist and tolerant Europe, but the obtuse and naked faith of the Middle Ages. Perhaps it's just because I'm a medievalist, but I find everything is medieval in 1492.